Hello. This is Let's Talk About Myths, Baby. Here with mini myth number 2, covering the gap of time where I'm in Athens and can't work on the next Iliad episode. Thank you for all your patience, and I do hope you enjoy these little tidbits. Honestly, they're really fun for me and give me the opportunity to cover a myth that simply doesn't have enough content to cover an entire episode. This myth comes from a combination of sources: Ovid's Metamorphoses and my go-to book, The Greek Myths by Robin Waterfield. It's mentioned in countless other sources, but those are mine. Which leads us to mini-myth, Pygmalion and Galatea, the gross origins of My Fair Lady. Pygmalion is a man from Cyprus. Cyprus, being Aphrodite's mythological birthplace, is a locale she takes a special interest in. There's a separate myth that says that Aphrodite, angered by the lack of piety of a group of Cypriot women, creates the first sex workers. This is, of course, a myth that vilifies the concept, making them the most shameful of women, and fuck that, but there's your context. Pygmalion is a man who's fallen in love with Aphrodite. He's chosen her because he so loathes these sex worker women he's heard of. Pygmalion is a straight-up misogynist who believes that there are just too many sins that women are naturally inclined towards, and so why would he trouble himself with such sinful and awful creatures? He's taken the example of these Cypriot sex workers and decided that all women are sinful and disgusting, but not Aphrodite. So in love with Aphrodite and so disturbed by women by and large, Pygmalion gives up on finding someone to spend his life with. What's the point? Not to sound repetitive, but come on, cool it on the toxic masculinity, ancients. Due to his disturbing opinions on the opposite sex, Pygmalion lives alone for a long time. Instead of trying to find a woman to spend his life with, he carves. He becomes an incredible sculptor, practicing his skills until he can finally sculpt the perfect likeness of Aphrodite. Pygmalion has sculpted his perfect woman. She's flawless, beautiful, a recreation of the goddess of love. Plus, she doesn't speak or have a mind of her own. Bonus for old Pygmalion. He wants a woman free of the sins of, you know, being a human fucking person. And he's found her in this sculpture. She just happens to also be a little cold and not particularly cuddly. But that doesn't deter Pygmalion. Pygmalion falls truly, madly, deeply in love with this statue. And when I say falls in love, I mean it. He kisses her and caresses her, but gently, afraid that he'll bruise her solid, rock-hard skin. Pygmalion names her Galatea, and he dresses her in the nicest clothes and brings her gifts. No word on whether he's offended by her lack of appreciation of the gifts. I just want to pause and say that this story has been wildly romanticized for the fact that it was a dude who was pissed at human women and made himself a fake one to fall in love with that wouldn't have thoughts or opinions. Men in ancient Greece were cool. A day arrives that is devoted to Aphrodite. A festival in her honor is being held on Cyprus, and Pygmalion will, of course, attend. She is his model of a perfect woman, after all. At the festival, Pygmalion brings an offering, and with it, a prayer. Pygmalion prays to Aphrodite that his sculpture of this perfect, irrational ideal of a perfect woman will come alive. The only thing he's missing was, you know, everything that would make her human. Pygmalion returns home from the festival. He goes, as usual, to his statue, Galatea, and gives her a kiss. But something's different this time. Her lips are soft and warmer than usual. He's gotten so used to pressing his mouth against cold marble. What a difference! Is that what lips feel like? He thinks to himself. They're so soft. Is this what warm, soft flesh feels like? It so nice. What have I been missing? He thinks. Because he's been living the most fucked up life up to now. Pygmalion looks into Galatea's eyes, and they're actually eyes. No more lifeless white rock staring back at him. According to this Waterfield book, he goes straight to her breasts. Shocker. Wait, he thinks, mind utterly fucking blown. They're supposed to be soft? Pygmalion is thrilled. Galatea is alive, and she's still got all the qualities he wanted. She has no opinions, doesn't talk much, and basically does everything he wants in every moment. The perfect woman. Oh, you thought there was more to this story? Maybe things went bad for Pygmalion because he has such disturbing views about women. Because he made an inanimate object to love because he's so convinced of the evils of the human women. You thought maybe he deserved an unhappy end to his story? No, that's it. But lucky for you, I'm not done. The story of Pygmalion is gross and weird, but thankfully it inspired the story of, well, also Pygmalion, but a different Pygmalion. George Bernard Shaw wrote his play, also called Pygmalion, based on the name and, kind of, the general concept of the myth. Thankfully, Eliza Doolittle is indeed a human woman. Of course, that's not to say the play isn't problematic, but isn't everything. I watched My Fair Lady as a kid, the play and the movie, and, well, you overlook the troubling aspect of why does a woman feel she has to change everything about herself to fit into a societally defined world? Because, well, that's the patriarchy, and isn't it well engraved in us? At least from what I remember of My Fair Lady, because honestly, it's been a couple decades at least, and the Wikipedia page only gives me act-specific plots, and that's just too much to read. Eliza does have some agency. She's the one who wants to change the way she speaks and acts. It's not forced upon her by a man, though it is, of course, taught to her by a man. But there's only so much to be done about this thing we call the patriarchy. Also, Pygmalion and My Fair Lady brought us She's All That, so come on, there's no touching that. It has Usher and that dance sequence, people. Thank you all for listening. Mini myths are super fun for me, so I hope they are for you. This one's a little short, but what can you do? It's like a quarter of the work! Woo! Okay, you're all the best. While you're hearing this, I'm in Greece, so, you know, follow me places so you can see the cool stuff I'm doing. I bet I'm eating olives and drinking wine right now. I'm not sure when I'll be back with a new episode. It may depend on how jet-lagged I am when I get back and how much of my regular job I have to get back to. I'll update you all on my Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, and I'm sure I'll be back before you know it. You're all awesome. I'm Liv, and I love this shit.